It's Andre from the High Performance Academy, and we're at World Time Attack with Andy from Adaptronic. And we wanted to investigate Andy's brand new modular range of ECUs and just get some insight on that. It's not often in this market that we see an innovative product come out. The market for aftermarket ECUs is relatively mature, and really the ECUs all in the mainstream do kind of the same thing. So Andy's new modular ECU is quite unique. So Andy, for a start, let's talk about what makes the modular range of ECUs unique.
Okay, I'll probably start off by describing some of the problems that we're trying to overcome. So what we found was that people often wanted to upgrade their systems, and so they'd start off with a lower level ECU and then add on other bits as required. And so they'd end up with this series of multiple boxes connected to the ECU, which ended up being quite messy. And the other problem is that at some point you're running out of outputs and connections that you can make on the ECU. So I wanted to make a system where people could upgrade the ECU over time and not commit to buying a system that was way beyond what they needed right now, and not be limited by buying a less expensive system at the beginning.
I think that's a situation a lot of people have been in when you're initially deciding to start out on a project, and you look at what you need, you pick a product that suits on paper, and then obviously the bug bites and you start modifying the car further, and all of a sudden you find that what you initially had that suited fine doesn't quite cover the full range of what you now need. So with the modular range of ECUs, you can purchase an ECU that covers your initial requirements, but then you can add to it. So tell us how that works.
Well, even the basic version of the modular ECU actually has a lot of inputs and outputs on it, so that should do like quite a few cases for people. But what the customer can do is they can buy additional modules which will give them more inputs or more outputs or more controls. So, for example, the basic M2000 ECU has, I think it's 15 analog inputs and 4 temperature inputs and lots of things like that. It has 8 injector, 8 ignition and 4 auxiliary outputs. But if you want more, you can just buy another module which gives you another 6 auxiliary outputs and put that in the same box. So you don't need to install another box and mount it and then wire it up and make everything messy.
So initially that M2000, that would be suitable, I'm guessing, there for a 4-cylinder or an 8-cylinder, up to an 8-cylinder engine with 8 injector and ignition outputs?
Yeah, so you can run an 8-cylinder engine direct fire and fully sequentially. The only question is 4 auxiliary outputs going to be enough to do what you want to do? You do get another 2 with the TACO and fuel pump as well. But if you want to run, an idle step motor and boost control and a few other things, then you're going to run out pretty quickly. So you'd probably need to get the additional module to do that.
Okay, so let's move to the bigger ECU. What's that capable of?
Well, that's called the M6000, and the basic version of the M6000 has got the same capability as the 2000. So it's still got the 8 ignition, 8 injection, but you can upgrade it a lot further. You can fit more modules into the box. So you can run up to 3 of the output modules. So you can run up to 24 injectors, 24 ignition, and you can run 4 of the smaller modules, and the smaller modules can be either a drive-by-wire controller, so you can run 4 drive-by-wire, or 6 auxiliary outputs, so you can run, another 24 auxiliary outputs on top of the other one. So I think that's 84 in total or something, I'm not sure.
So shouldn't really limit you too much, so we're talking V12s with quad variable, cam control, dual drive-by-wire, that sort of thing, really advanced engines?
Yeah, that's what we basically planned it for. So in addition to that, the fuel control's got two completely separate channels. So on a V12, we've got 2 separate throttle bodies and 2 separate inlet manifolds. You can run a separate map sensor on each and control each bank as a completely separate engine, basically.
How's that addressed from the tuner's perspective? Probably getting a little bit off topic there, but just because that's quite interesting and unique, how's that dealt with by the tuner?
Well, there's only one fuel map. So the ECU basically looks at the fuel map twice, one for each bank. And on the screen where you've got your injector milliseconds, you have 2 different injector milliseconds, one for each bank.
So it's modifying the injector millisecond pulse width per bank based on the manifold pressure reading for that particular bank, is that?
It's not a modification. It actually does all the fuel calculations twice. So they're two completely independent things. And similarly with boost control, you can run two separate boost control loops if you've got a separate turbocharger on each side running into...
That sounds great. Now, the actual process, or the software, the firmware that's operating in the background, though, that's exactly the same between the two ECUs?
Yeah, that's right. And the way that you can control so many outputs with running the same processor without everything slowing down is because each additional module that you buy has got its own processor on it. And so you've got enough power to do
it. So essentially there's no downside if you've got a basic ECU, or you've got it fully optioned out with all of the additional modules, there's no downsides to that in terms of processing power.
Correct, that's right. Some additional calculation features slow the ECU down a little bit. So for example, if you want to run individual correction maps for each cylinder, then the ECU's got to look up each of those correction maps each time. But even still, the testing that we've been doing recently, the ECU is running at about 1,000 hertz main loop speed, which is very fast, so that's not a problem.
Yeah, what we're seeing with a lot of cars these days, or a lot of modern aftermarket ECUs and additional aftermarket componentry, electronics, is a lot of now relying on CAN communications so that we can read in data from other modules and then send out data perhaps to dashes. How are you dealing with that with the modular ECU?
Well, basically the M2000's got a single CAN port, and the M6000's got two CAN ports on it. What we have is several pre-configured CAN templates, is I believe the vernacular that a lot of the other manufacturers use. So you can just select, whether you want to output in the, say the MoTeC compatible format or something like that to drive to a dash which already supports that. And inputs, again, we can have inputs for, say, the lambda CAN. Converters from MoTeC, that sort of thing. In terms of making it fully configurable for people, so that people can reverse engineer factory car protocols and then implement them themselves, haven't done that yet. It is on the cards, and I'm aware that some applications are going to need that, but that's not the highest priority right now.
One aspect I want to focus on, because as far as I'm aware, this is completely unique. I haven't seen it before, is the onboard knock control that you're using. And this comes back to your older select ECUs as well. Not control, obviously nothing particularly new there, but you have an onboard audio jack, a 3.5mm audio jack, so the tuner can plug a headset straight into the ECU and listen for knock. And how's that all work?
I don't know why other manufacturers haven't done this. I've seen, I guess when I started tuning, I had a lot of mentors helped me, and they all had these knock boxes which they hooked up to the engine and listened with their headphones, and I thought, well, hang on a second, we've got a knock sensor connected to the ECU, why don't we amplify that and filter it so the tuner can listen to it and not have to have another box, because yourself, when you're in the car, you've got two keyboards here and everything, and it all gets quite messy. So I thought, well, why don't we just eliminate a box and a bunch of wires and just have someone be able to plug it into the ECU. So
It makes a lot of sense, and obviously as well, you then don't need the additional expense of an external or additional knock box or knock audio detector. So yeah, it makes a lot of sense to me. Now, these ECUs right now, as I understand it, they're really kind of in beta testing. They're not quite available for public consumption yet. Can you give us some indication of how long it will be before these are available to retail customers?
About 4 weeks. At the moment, we're held up with some of our suppliers for that manufacture the components that we're using. But that's the time frame that I've been given. So when I say 4 weeks, what's that? Mid-November, that'll be.
And if someone's interested in finding out more or purchasing one of these ECUs, how could they go about doing that?
The best way is to contact our sales guys at sales@adaptronic.com.au. We are looking for certain cars to develop good base maps on for these ECUs. We're open to have more beta testers as well as sales when they're ready.
All right, well, look, thanks for giving us some insight into that ECU, Andy. It is a really exciting product. I look forward to seeing it meet the market soon. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Andre.